Good morning, everyone. This is Kathy Mason from Mason Works Marketing here on Conscious Business Zone today with Andrea Isaacs. Hi, Andrea. How are you?
Hi, Kathy. I'm great. Thanks.
Yeah, I'm so glad you're on because I have tons of questions for you and I hope everyone else does too. So, Andrea, just so everyone knows, the reason why I wanted you to meet Andrea is that I've known about her work for, I bet, 12 years, maybe longer, where she's been doing the Enneagram and traveling the world, helping people live a better life. So first I wanted to read a little bit from her website so that I don't mess up her bio, but she's, Andrea Isaacs is called a master of change and a spiritual teacher extraordinaire. Her work blends emotional intelligence, the Enneagram, body wisdom, neuroscience, and spirituality, so you can live and be your best self no matter what. So let's start with this. How did you get started in this? Well, because I know you lived in California, starting your spirituality or part of your spiritual journey. Good morning. Kimberly Foster's here. She says hello.
Hi, Kimberly. Oh,
isn't this fun? So anyway, you start wherever you sure want, but I'm curious because I don't know anyone else that does this.
Well, how this started, I could give you a short answer or a long answer. The long answer is actually kind of relevant, but I'll just give you sort of highlights of the longer answer.
Okay.
And what started this journey was, I was so shy as a young person. I didn't know how to be. I didn't know how to do life. It was just so confusing and so many decisions and people and emotions. And I was so caught up in my inner emotional life that I wasn't, I didn't know how to implement that in the world. So it started really as a young child, not knowing how to be. Fast forward many years, I came across things that helped me find myself, find answers to who am I and how do I be, especially if someone's pushing my buttons. Because my old reaction used to be to do nothing, say nothing, and then hold it in and be really angry, but just be fine on the outside. Ooh, no, you know what? I bet that's familiar to a lot of people. Having an emotional reaction that you don't express, or one that you express and you feel like justified because you're speaking your truth and you kind of overdo it and it doesn't come across well and it tends to push people away.
Right.
So I came up first, I was choreographing. I became a dancer and I learned how to communicate emotions through movement, translating emotional energy to physical energy. And after doing that for many years, I came across the Enneagram. And because of my background, it was such a perfect marriage, so to speak, of my movement work embodying emotion and the Enneagram, which is all about different kinds of personality styles that have different emotions. And I'm like, well, of course you could put movement with that. It was so clear to me that it must exist. I was sure it did. And it didn't. And after having a life of like moving and rehearsing and teaching and so on, 12 hours a day, I went to this Enneagram training and I sat in a chair for, I don't know, 10 hours a day for a week. And I thought something's missing here. So the beginning of this journey, to answer your question, was the combination of my two passions, really. And yes, bringing movement together with the Enneagram.
Wow. Well, so most classes are like that. It feeds your brain, but it may feed your heart in some ways, but it doesn't feed the body. And this is the vehicle, right? So,
yeah, this is how we function in the world. Even if we have trouble with mobility, we still have these bodies that engage us with the world.
Right.
And, you know, it's the Enneagram is really interesting intellectually. And as you were just saying, we could feel it too. And a lot of people, after they know the Enneagram for a period of time, say something, well, I just don't know what to do with it. What does this mean? How can this make my life better?
Right. Those are the questions I have, because can you be two different numbers? Can you be combinations? I mean, and can you grow from one number to another?
I love your question. So just
I have tons of them.
So to back up, Ennea means nine in Greek. So the Enneagram describes nine different personality styles. And yet emotionally, I would say we all have such a huge range of emotion that it's sometimes is hard to say, well, that's a type four emotion or three or two. In some ways, it really isn't necessary. However, okay. To back up your question, can you be two types? We are primarily one core type. And there's okay. pretty much agreement about that in the field. And in my, I have an EQ assessment, EQ quiz assessment based on the Enneagram. When you take your assessment, you see that you're not just one type. You have a primary core type, yes. And then you can see on the chart the way you have how much and how little of the gifts and the challenges of all nine types. So it's like you're not just one, you are one core type. But what's so interesting to me is as I develop this quiz and talk to people about the results afterwards, is all of the scores impact each other and impact you to either lift you up and empower you and explains why you're good at what you're good at, why you love what you love. Uh-huh. And it shows how the scores impact each other and impact you to cause you that same old stress and struggle again and again. And they become, I call them whammies. They become, it's like a knockout punch. It's really hard to shift when you have a bunch of whammies. Then you have double whammies, triple whammies, and so on. And these challenges, it's not like, you got all this work to do, but we can look at the chart and realize there's something that we can shift. There's one thing we can shift that can change everything.
So it's when you're saying that, so it's the good things and the bad things. So is it shadow work almost when you see the bad things? Is that?
Well, yeah, I don't like to call them good and bad because some of the bad emotions, I call them emotions, disturbing emotions that we don't like, that don't feel good, that we want less of.
Okay.
It's a long way to say bad emotions, but you know, they come up for a reason. And what's interesting to me is it's useful to look at what called why it happened, why that emotion came up, and then we can shift it. So it is a form of shadow work. I am trained as a shadow work coach. Although even before that training, I had my own version of shadow work. And we also put things that are good into our shadow. It's like maybe my confidence is in the shadow because I'm afraid. This is hypothetical, but it used to be true for me, actually. I could be afraid that if I held my confidence, that I might come across as arrogant. I was afraid of arrogance. So I threw arrogance into my shadow. And what happens when you throw the dark side into the shadow is we tend to throw the light side in. So we have a light shadow, say in this case, confidence. I put my confidence in the shadow. And we have the dark shadow. So I call it the dark shadow. You know, the stuff we don't like that we want less of. I call it the dark shadow because, I'll just pause there.
Okay. So there's nine archetypes. Yes. And once you decide and how, so in a quiz, and I'll put the link up for the quiz, although I've got your website up first for anybody that wants to read more and see how incredibly talented Andrea is. Here's her website, and then I'll put up the link later. So I find out what I am, and then how do I then, is this like a personality test, like Myers-Briggs, where you figure out what your attributes are and it helps you communicate better with other people? Or is this a self-love tool? How does it work?
Well, it's kind of a yes, yes, and yes. So let's see if we can back up to what the questions were. Kind of like MBTI, Myers-Briggs type indicator, in that there's a determination this is probably your type. What you get in your automated email after taking the quiz is a series of information about what that means. And the conversation with me is individualized because it's not just about your core type. It's about the whole picture. I sometimes call it the holistic Enneagram. And so in a conversation with me, you actually see that whole picture about how your scores impact each other. There is an interpretation guide that is generic. It explains to a degree what each gift looks like when it's there fully embodied and what it looks like when it's not there and sort of a mid-range. So you get a picture of that. And same thing with the challenges. There's a guide describing what happens when your challenge is really strong or if it's not there at all, and then something in between. So you get that description. It gives you a feeling of what all nine types are.
Okay. And so is most of this work done one-on-one, or is it done in group also?
Well, I have both. And then the one-on-one and group also happen both virtually like this and also in live events. So it usually starts out with a conversation because, people don't know me. They want to go, who is she? Is this weird? Or does this make sense? How does this make sense to me? Or what do I have to learn here? So I love curiosity. I love asking questions and being asked questions. And when I'm asked questions, it pulls out something from me that I might not have thought of. So it's a real, I think it's a really enjoyable and deep and often life-changing conversation in itself for people, because I'm just looking at their pie chart, this blueprint of the personality. I'm just looking at, you know, this piece of paper, so to speak. And I'm telling them things about themselves that they've kind of known or didn't know. And there's so much insight when we go around the whole circle with that whole picture in mind. Because again, it's not just about your core type. So there's a lot of really deep learning. And then sometimes they are not sometimes. So what's really valuable is not only seeing how those scores are impacting you in your daily life, so you don't have to repeat the same old stress and struggle.
Right.
There's also a virtual program, which is pre-recorded. You watch at your own time, that goes through all the 9 types and teaches you how to embody more of the gifts and less of the challenges of each of them.
Well, so I have a friend, Char, that took Enneagram class, and she would just go, oh, that person's a this, and that person's a that. And it was almost like she categorized him in a negative way. Like, well, and it was almost like she was looking for the negative of each thing. So that's why I was asking, because I want to feel like we're evolving and that we can evolve. So that's why I asked about the shadow and et cetera, because that's how you evolve to the highest version of yourself, correct?
Yeah, actually saying so many things here. I want to respond to about the shadow and about calling people particular types. You know, the type thing is very obvious when someone's in their dark shadow. Like if you're a critical person and you go into this real critical rage or whatever, it's you know, that's when we really see type. When someone is really healthy, it's not as expressed as articulately, or you have to look more subtly. It's really a more subtle look, like because one person could be really, you know, in their highest self, and what they're about is peace, or they could be in their highest self, and what they're about is service, or vision. You know, it evolves. It's different. It's a different subtlety. There is that tendency. Of course, we want to recognize ourselves, and we want to recognize the other people in our world. I think we have to be careful though about claiming, hey, you're it's because you're being a 3 right now, or you're being such a 5, or that does drive me crazy. It could be that this person is illustrating behavior of an unhealthy version of a particular type, and that's why you're not trusting me right now. Rather than saying you're such a 6, you're such an unhealthy 6, like you're not trusting me at all. I mean, that I hear that kind of thing a lot. Rather than maybe something.
I wondered because I thought, you know, the gene codes and human design, I did human design, a lot of these, and then there was higher alignment here in Boulder. I used to rent my office space from them. And it was it was hard to evolve out of when they gave you that label. And so that's been my resistance. Even Myers-Briggs and all of that, I found Myers-Briggs and DISC to be helpful for communication, especially in team, because then you could see what people's natural inclination was and actually work with them better. But as far as the labeling and that you're stuck with it your whole life, it's like, I don't know.
That happens not just with DISC and human design. It happens in the Enneagram community as well. And what I want people to know is who you are is not etched in stone. How you've always reacted is not etched in stone. You don't always have to do what you always used to do. You don't have to be that person if you want to change. If you have the tools that make change easy, then you can learn that, you know, as human beings, it's important to learn that we can have that emotional flexibility. We have the range and the capacity. And this is what I train people to do. I don't want to be like that. I'd rather be like, oh, I know how to do that now. And I can shift my reactivity. And this is one of the gems of having the life you want. Because, you know, we are surrounded by people and situations that support us and or push our buttons. How do we manage that? And this helps us manage it with ease and grace, with that feeling of wholeness. And yes, you know, transcending into something that's more connected, more spiritual.
That's so cool. So did you find you used to teach the any emotion internationally? You were always off to Germany or somewhere. Do you find that there's a lot of difference in the way the cultures, different international cultures, use it?
Yes and no. There is what I would call a cultural overlay. When I was in the Far East, China and Japan, Hong Kong, Korea, there is a very serious honoring of authority, of teachers. You could say that for those who know the Enneagram, you could say it's a type 6 culture where there's a lot of loyalty to an organization or to their country. And mm-hmm. and because of that, there's a kind of, there's a rigidity sometimes in how they express emotionally. When I was in South Korea, for example, there had been a war in their lifetime. And it's like there was an unspoken agreement not to talk about the pain. And in my work, something opened up for one woman there who tapped into her pain. And we did an incredible process and the whole room just deepened into their own pain. And then I had more private sessions than I had imagined. And the stories I heard about what people suffered, and then the ability to transition, to transform that reactivity and have a new spark in life was so moving. That was a very unique situation.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what we're here for, isn't it? And to learn how to make conscious choices. That's what conscious business zone is. Yes. Is we're hopefully highlighting resources that help everyone make better choices and live a happier life because of those choices. I want you to know that Zach Bergen, who's a physicist, and he always has great questions. He wrote, emotions should be seen as indicators and absent of polarity. They should all be welcomed. Caveat, all behaviors are not acceptable. I believe that emotions are an emotional compass, and how we respond is the learning.
Oh, that's so beautiful.
Yeah, he keeps going, but you can see he gets it.
he's absolutely right. And, yeah. You know, what's interesting is people have different sort of blocks in different parts of the journey towards expressing it. Some people, as I was saying earlier, would hold it in and hold it in and hold it in. As if I were to express it out to you, for instance, if I was angry, maybe I would hurt your feelings, or I would lose you as a friend, or I would do or say something I'd later regret. It's that is having my emotion be in charge of me.
Right.
That
right.
is an indicator that something happened that needs to be expressed. And my challenge now is to express it in a way that's, there, I hold my ground, I speak my truth, but I do it with that, you know, in the right way, with right amount of energy to the right person at the right time. And this is our life challenge.
Yeah. So in my experience, boundaries are always interesting because I tend to want to do more than I'm contracted to do. And then there's that, like, oops, that wasn't in the contract. So the expectation changes. And I find myself, I've just been working on this week, just, you know, it's like, why are you reacting, overreacting? It's my stuff. It's not their stuff. It isn't. It's my need to get an A+.
Well, yes. You know, I had this interesting insight about a new way to look at that kind of thing, say boundaries. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. And there's so much that could be said about this, but this is what is current for me right now.
Okay.
Because I just moved, as you know, and in moving, going through all my things, everything is a decision. And not just in my life, like, do I keep these books? Do I keep this clothing? What, you know, and also in my business, I had to go through a change during the move. And there was, as my coach told me, is decision fatigue.
Right.
Oh, so yeah. This is what came up for me as a way to manage decisions. When our decisions are made with the intention of harmony in wholeness. I want to say that again. Harmony. There is harmony in wholeness. When our decisions are made in harmony with wholeness,
beautiful.
Then there's peace. You know, if we're in harmony with wholeness, the inner critic who could say, that was wrong. You shouldn't have kept that. You should have gotten rid of that. You should have done this. Why didn't you do that? You know, that's where the inner critic will go. However, when you are in alignment and in the knowingness that this decision is in the harmony of wholeness, then the inner critic doesn't have a chance.
Right.
I mean, really, it shuts it up. And I noticed that because, oh, well, yeah. And you could stop thinking about it and go on to what's next.
It's just trying to protect you. It's the ego. It's just trying to protect you.
But, so we put it to rest by saying, you know what? You can rest because it's in harmony with wholeness. Right. And then there's this phrase I've had lately about the lightness in the rightness. And when your decisions are in harmony with wholeness, you also stand in the rightness. I don't have to be like self-righteous. It's just, I just know there's rightness. And then I feel lightness.
The rightness in the lightness?
There's lightness in the rightness.
The lightness. Okay.
I found that by feeling the rightness first. And then I felt in my body that the lightness. So my mantra to remind myself in decision-making is there's lightness in harmony with wholeness? Then there's lightness in the rightness.
So how do you incorporate movement with the Enneagram work when you're working through people's stuff? Like, for instance, if I came to you and I said, I got to work on this boundary thing, I can't do it anymore. Mm-hmm. So we're on a video call like this, mm-hmm. and you can't really do show me like a ballerina.
Okay. So I would guide you through a process. I'll do it if you want to join me. You're welcome to. Pardon me?
Sure. Everybody will benefit.
Oh, let's help for this together. Sure. And let me describe why we're going to do this first. Okay. So it's like creating an antidote. So to describe antidote, imagine you're bit by a poisonous snake. You could die. However, there's an antidote that has some of the venom of that snake. And if you get the right antidote, it saves your life.
Right.
So with that in mind, we all have our own unique version of our emotional venom. Uh-huh. And just take a moment, everybody who's listening, take a moment and just notice what yours is. It's a little different and it's unique for each of us. So in other words, Kathy, I can't take your antidote. My work might be all right, but you know, it won't be as strong as if I do my own antidote.
Right.
Now, having said that, they are all useful and will initiate change right away, even if it's not the perfect antidote yet. But I just want you to know it's deeper when it does come from you. And then we have your venom, and then it builds the antidote, and it's powerful for supporting the change you want.
Good.
Okay, so Kathy, when you are saying yes, 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 and you take on more than you meant to do, what's that like energetically in your body? Are you like in go, 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 go mode?
Actually, what happens is I'm okay until something doesn't go right. Because as soon as something doesn't go right, then I'm stressed that I don't have enough time. So because I actually schedule my time. So as soon as something doesn't go right, then there's the fear. It's a fear and anxiousness that comes up.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And that's in my gut. It's more.
In your gut.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So we need to turn the volume up on what's happening in the body. And what I mean by turning the volume up is we're going to exaggerate whatever it is. So the energy of anxiety, is it something that moves quickly? Like, is it an inner energy like that? Or?
It's like a treadmill or like an animal, you know, those gophers or whatever they have, you know,
the hamster wheel.
That's what it feels like in my gut, that it's just spinning.
Cool. That's a really great image. Spinning in my gut like a hamster wheel.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Let's take that image because that's really powerful. And it's one I can see and feel also. So let's take the hamster wheel and instead of just in your gut, do it in your hands, do it in your arms. So it's just bigger. Yeah. And spinning, 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 spinning. And there's anxiety in there and there's fear. So feel your breath of fear. Feel the breath of fear. Yeah. So keep it going for just another moment. Imagine you have to do that all day long. And maybe you do sometimes on the inside. Yeah. And do you like that?
No.
Keep going and ask your body what your body would prefer. What would your body rather do?
Stop it.
Try to stop it. Try to stop it. Try to stop it. You do it again. You can't do it again. Do it again. Do
it again. Have to keep stopping it. Because it's like a brake. You got to put the brake on and
Right. And when you do that, feel your feet on the ground.
Yeah.
Plant your feet. Yeah, they did that already, didn't they? Probably naturally. Both feet connected to the ground. And you do this kind of gesture. And when I do that, my spine gets long and straight and I get wider and taller. Did that happen to you?
Yeah. Yeah. And I felt like my breath, I was breathing in the channel, whereas before I was breathing shallow.
Yes. Let's keep this as part of your, we call it a mudra. I'll explain that in a minute. Uh-huh. You're breathing in the channel and then you plant it. Yeah. Yeah. You can do a whole circle and then plant. Whole circle and plant. Yes. And then a whole circle and plant. And feeling, you do one more time and hold it this time. Hold it. Now ask your body, feeling this energy in your body. Let your body inform your mind. And give me an I statement that captures this feeling in your body. I am
grounded. I am safe.
I am safe.
Yeah, that's what that was. It felt unsafe.
Uh-huh. Would you like I'm safe and grounded? Would you like
that? Uh-huh. Yeah, sure.
Do it again. I am safe and grounded.
I am safe and grounded.
I wonder if this is the safe part. Is this the safe part?
My heart, the heart and all of that. Honestly, it feels like before it felt like not butterflies. I mean, it felt like it was racing and that there was, it wasn't in one spot. It was like a region. And then this movement caused me to breathe deeply and bring it in through anyway. So it moved it. And took it, it put a brake on. But I don't know how to explain it better than that.
That's okay. Doing it is more important. I'm safe and grounded. And you know what? You could do that smaller. I'm safe and grounded. And even smaller. I'm safe. You can do it quieter.
I'm safe and grounded.
I could do it quietly in my mind and have that same feeling in my body. And here's the neuroscience part, and there's more to say about this, but we don't have time for. The neuroscience part is doing that is training and strengthening this neural pathway. It changes the brain, changes the energy in your body, and this is what changes how you think, how you feel, and how you show up in life.
Wonderful. So do you give a recipe like this to your clients and then say, do it, 5 times in the morning, 5 times at night, or
it's not that rigid or structured, but there is like homework. The homework is to practice, and I always send you the mantra. The mantra is a word or phrase, and the mudra is the body position. Traditionally, it's a prayer or meditation position. I send that to you, and it's as a reminder. And your job is to practice. And I have clients who make flashcards. They put them on key rings with little hole punches, so they can flip through them. One of them is an artist. She draws pictures for each one, and sometimes there's a whole almost like a meditation that I elicit from you that brings you to this point. Like, why is safety so important? There's something that just gives the reassurance and reminds you in the way that you need to hear, because it comes from you. I elicit it from you. And those are so beautiful and really powerful.
And you don't really have to know what the reason was that I might have felt unsafe, which I probably know from childhood, but you don't have to go to that story, right? So you don't have to relive the story necessarily.
Well, that's true. And the energy of the story is useful. Sometimes we're not ready to do that first session. We get used to each other a bit first and make sure it's safe for you to do that. And when the time is right, then it is useful. And again, though, as you say, I don't need the story, but the energy in your body when the story was happening, that's the venom that we need to antidote. And we only antidote it by getting a little bit of it. You know, I don't have to go on for an hour session hearing the story. That's what talk therapy does, and there is a time and place for that. But this is not that. This is just getting enough to the transformation, yeah.
Well, and this is different. I took Avatar, and Avatar, there's a process that you use where you feel the fear, let's say that was fear, or resistance, feel that, then you feel the opposite, and you go back and forth and back and forth until you get a center. And this is more than center, this is to the better feeling, right, Andrea?
Yes.
You feel the better feeling, not to 0 point.
I totally agree with that. And also, when we have the flexibility, if say this is anger and this is confidence, and that is one polarity, and I was so afraid of the anger, I just stepped out of that polarity and I had no confidence. So yes, sometimes right in the middle is perfect. However, with this emotional range of flexibility, sometimes I need to raise my voice a little bit I say, wait, stop. But we need to talk about this. And if you don't listen and things aren't going well, I may need to do something different. Like, no, wait a minute. Please stop. This is hurtful. So there's a gauge. And we can shift to anywhere on that gauge, more or less. So the whole thing is something that you have access to and you have choice.
Cool. Okay. So I have another weird question for you. a lot of the spiritual healers right now are talking about the reunification of the divine masculine and divine feminine. And how would you use the Enneagram for that process?
This is a beautiful question, and one I have also pondered for some time. I think my response might be a little, well, I don't know. I might be in alignment with what you've heard. So you could say that one Enneagram type called the boss or the leader, the challenger, it's known as type eight, is a traditionally a cultural male archetype. Okay. There are women type eights, of course, but it's a male archetype. And type two, often called the nurturer, the giver, the helper, and so on, it could be the cultural female archetype. Mm-hmm. So with that in mind, there are certain qualities that they both have. And in my opinion, it's useful for all of us, again, that I call the pendulum learning curve, to have access to every bit on the spectrum at times. There are times where I need to be more masculine in my world. I need to, that's building a business, having a goal, moving towards it. These are more masculine direct qualities.
Right.
And if I hold on, if sometimes we get habituate to what we do in our work day, especially if you're in a corporate environment. If I were to habituate to that, my romantic relationships would also have me in my masculine. I don't want to be in my masculine in a romantic relationship. There might be times I want to initiate, of course, but for me, it was really interesting to fully step into my feminine, consciously say, no, I just want to be receptive. I started to get that in one way with ballroom dance, because there's leader follower. Uh-huh. In a way, the leader is usually the man, though there are same-sex people who dance together, of course. And I dance with women, and but the one person has to lead in ballroom, and one person follows. It is the ultimate of femininity. I wait for the lead, and I don't move until I receive the lead. And there's something, like if you could just translate that emotionally or in business to listen to other perspectives, just receive. So culture, go back to your question about merging the divine male and female. We need to do that in ourselves first. And as we honor both sides,
wow, that was weird. Are you there? Can you hear me?
I'm here. I don't know what happened. Yes.
I don't either. My camera went off and I kept hitting the button and it.
Oh, yeah. Well, here we are.
Sorry, technical. We don't. They. I guess the powers that be didn't want to know about that.
Oh my. What did you miss? I don't remember. Well, doesn't matter.
No, it's fine. I was just saying that, we're in a spiritual awakening right now. That's why I can even have a show called Conscious Business. I mean, the word conscious and love and all of these terms weren't in the business world even 2 years, 5 years ago. I mean, it's just like yoga. Nobody knew what yoga was 10 years ago, not that many people knew 10 years ago, and now it's a general term. So, and meditation. So you're seeing this huge change. And are you seeing the Enneagram changing with the times too? Are you seeing, I mean, obviously the motion, the physical motion that you added to it is a big change, but are you seeing it evolve too?
Well, actually, yes. In fact, this last summer, I was a keynote speaker for the International Enneagram Association's conference. And my topic was, it was covering the history of somatic or body work and the Enneagram. And also, the subtitle was In Every Cell of Your Body. And for me, that phrase, the subtitle, was really important, because the purpose of my work is to feel whatever it is you want to feel in every cell of your body. Because when you do that, feel in every cell of your body, you activate that neural pathway, which changes the brain, as I was saying before. It changes the energy in your body, changes how you think, feel, and respond to life. So that's the reason for all of this. And what I noticed in putting together the history of somatic work in the Enneagram, though a little bit existed before, it wasn't related to type very much.
Uh-huh.
Although Oscar Ichazo did create mudras, body positions for each type, but it wasn't, it was a stillness pose. It didn't have movement in it. So I've taught like hundreds, thousands of people probably around the world, and I am still traveling internationally. My students have begun to teach. Other schools started to see the value of somatic work, and other schools started. So initially they're like all these, I really opened the doorway, actually. Someone called me the grandmother of somatic work in the Enneagram. And then there was another pillar, and then there was another, and then another, and now there are many. And what's happened is each of those pillars, their students started to teach. And then those, the clouds of those pillars started to connect. And so something different is about to emerge in that world. And it really excites me. It's beautiful because the value is seen. As mindfulness has gone into corporate structure, my work is just a step beyond after mindfulness. So after you're mindful, what can you do to change a situation, change your reactivity? You have to be mindful first. So it's really just a next step after mindfulness that could easily integrate into a corporate setting.
Oh, I think it's wonderful. And with all the corporate, the manpower in every corporation has multiple generations in it. It's not like when we were younger and there was only two generations. Now sometimes there's four or more, and each generation has a different value and a different perspective to life. So I would see your work as being so, so powerful. Plus, it allows you to really be aware of the other.
Yeah.
It really, even though we're saying work on yourself first, which is the conscious thing to do, we interact in this play of life with others, and we want to do that in a beautiful way.
Well, that's part of the journey that I describe when people work with me. It starts with emotional mastery, as you say, just with yourself and having that range and flexibility. And then the next phase is, because we're not here to do life alone, it's relational mastery.
Right.
And if we don't address that properly, we're not going to move into our life mastery with ease or grace. And that's really, I think, the goal.
Oh, that's perfect. Okay. Well, I wanted to have you talk a little bit about your quiz real quick. And I'll put the link up real quick, sure. But love to have you invite the listeners to experience this.
Well, thank you. So yes, the quiz is, Kathy has the link there. It takes maybe 5-10 minutes at the most. So it's easy to do. And you'll immediately get a blueprint of your results. It's called your emotional mastery blueprint. And the value of that really is, I would say, let's have a conversation about your blueprint, because it's not just about what type you are. You will learn your gifts and strengths that you already know, and some maybe you haven't recognized. Because actually, for many of us, our genius zone is something that's so natural to us, we don't even see it.
Yeah.
And as I reflect it back to you, it'll make it even easier and more powerful for you to stand in that strength.
Yeah.
And then we see how the challenges impact you. And they'll be familiar. And I can be blunt, but people tend not to take it personally because they know I don't know them, and I'm just reading reading your scores. And the insight from that will help you not only understand your reactivity, it will help you understand someone else's reactivity, so that what Kathy was just talking about, getting relational mastery,
gets
easier. That happens. As you understand your emotions better, you communicate better, all of your relationships improve. And then whatever it is you're doing with life, whether it's leadership or friendship or love and romance, you can embody whatever it is you're here to do. Stand in the value of what's important to you. You could grow your business in the way that best reflects your values, embody your message, and make the impact you're here to make.
So it's an instant, you get the answers instantaneously after you take the quiz. And then you walk them through how to do it.
So the next thing you get is an interpretation guide.
Okay.
That is somewhat generic. I described that a little earlier. You'll get that guide. I don't remember if it's 2 hours later or the next day, but you will get the interpretation guide. Okay. And it will make some sense to you. Although for some people, an 8 score is really high. For other people, an 8 score is really low. And I go into detail about why that is relevant to you.
Okay.
And then there's what I call the whammies webinar. I talked about the challenges being a whammy, like knockout punch.
Mm-hmm.
I have a webinar. It's a little, like an hour, maybe hour and 15 minute training on what that means. I go around the whole circle, all of your scores. So you can look at your chart and see how it relates to if you have a whammy or a superpower or what. So there's a webinar that will add a lot of insight. And then I think the next thing is the invitation to talk to me. And I would love to talk with each of you, anybody who's here listening, I'd love to talk with you and point to whatever I see there.
That's fantastic. So tell us a story or two of the huge changes that you've seen, because I'm sure all these years that you've been doing this, that Korean story was amazing. But can you give us some ideas of some stories where the people were in pain and then they were in joy? Or
I have so many, it's almost hard to choose, but one did pop to the forefront. So here's the story.
Okay.
I'll call him Walt. Okay. So Walt, I was a senior leader at an international organization.
Okay.
And his boss sent him to me as a tough nut. Okay. And apparently he had anger issues at work. He had had anger issues in his marriage and was divorced twice because of that. He had young children who were afraid of him because of his anger. And he knew about it, but didn't know how to control it. And this is the, you know, it wasn't even his shadow because he already, you know, knew it was there, but it was, his shadow was running him instead of him being in charge. So essentially he came to me, you know, to be a better leader.
Uh-huh.
And as we did our work together, what came up was some old childhood stuff that we shifted. I didn't need the whole story. I don't know. I never need to know the whole story, but energetically we shifted it. Uh-huh. And I want to show you and tell you as best I can the video what he did. Now, I didn't tell him to do any of this. This 1,000% came from him. So he stood up and his arms just dropped down to the floor. And he said, "I dropped the baggage." There's more, but one phrase at a time. Just feel that one. Yeah. "I dropped the baggage." And he had a history of it. He was dropping. And, you know, a little of it shed each time. And then over time, even more and more and more would shed. "I dropped the baggage." And then he took a step forward and he simply said, "And stand in the ring of emotion."
Oh.
Now, this guy was a tough guy. I thought he was going to say like a boxing ring. "I step into the ring of emotion. I step into the ring of emotion." And he just stood there and felt himself being in the ring of emotion.
Okay.
And then he said, his arm circles around like this in front of his heart center. He says, "My whole heart is present." And he just felt, and I felt it. And then he moved his hands forward and he reached forward and he said, "I'm ready for a new way to love."
Oh.
And tears were streaming down his face. "I drop the baggage, step into the ring of emotion. My whole heart is present and I'm ready for a new way to love."
And he said that without your prompting?
Well, I guided him through a process and this was his outcome.
Oh my gosh.
Now, if he walked in the room and I said, "Oh, you know, Walt, you should say these words because it'll be good for you," he would have walked out that door.
Yeah.
He would have said, "F you," and walked out that door. I don't doubt that. But that's not what happened. I elicited this from him. And as he walked down the hallway, I saw him walking away. He was texting his boss, and who reported to me later about how powerful the session was. This will not only teach him a new way to love in his new marriage, he in his new relationship. He wasn't remarried yet, but he didn't want to blow it like he had before. And he didn't want his kids to be afraid of him.
Right.
And you know, how we do anything is how we do everything. So you know that's going to shift him at work. He will be a different leader. He will have more compassion. He'll have more heart connection because his whole heart is present.
Without all the trauma. That's what I think that since 2012, we don't have to have divorces, have near-death experiences. We don't have to do it that way anymore. That's why I want everyone to know about the Enneagram and your work, because if they've got a block that they need to really, that they want, they're ready. ready to not have that story and to release it, that I recommend Andrea's work. And I think you'll find it, even though it is an emotional work, it is fun. She's got a energy level that makes it not so scary and fast. So you don't have to stay there. And that's what I was talking about with the story. Once you go to the story and re-energize the story, you're stuck again. And this is the time to get rid of it. Free up the energy so you can co-create with the universe and bring your gifts in. This is the time, right?
Yeah. You know, telling that old story not only keeps the old neural pathways alive, it strengthens them each time you tell the story.
Yuck.
Right. And I want people to know change can't be easy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, there's Linda Moore's here and Kimberly's here and Cheryl Stegman's here. And so, but I don't see any questions. If anybody has a question, this is the time. If you'd like, Kimberly asked me a question, but this is, if anybody has a question for Andrea, we'd love to see if we can get some more gems, because I really appreciate everything you've told us. And I really think that this, you know, the ancient truth that's almost like mystery school wisdom work that's coming out again, the Enneagram and mudras, those are ancient knowledge. It's ancient knowledge that it's time for us to bring those tools back and utilize them.
And
excuse me?
I was agreeing. I'm sorry. And I missed what you had said after that.
Well, and updated. That's why I was asking, how is it changing? Because I think making it more useful by you using the internet as an access point, by you being able to be. Okay. So Kimberly Foster says, how long does it take for those neural pathways to change?
Thank you, Kimberly. Hi again. Well, you know, this is a really fun question, because there's been research about, 27 times or 3 months or this. I've heard that. However, because this work creates a new neural pathway right then and there, that neural pathway becomes a part of who you are. And that means if you're mindful, and yes, mindfulness is essential. When you're mindful and you notice the old pattern arising, you go, I just learned this new mantra and mudra. And you can say it quietly in your mind, like I did with Kathy a moment ago. And it changes the energy in your body. It energizes that neural pathway that you've trained. It's there. You energize it. It changes the energy in your body. And it will change how you think, feel, and respond in that next moment. So, you know, change can be immediate. Now, of course, you know, the more you practice it, the stronger the neural pathway gets, the more immediate that shift happens.
Uh-huh.
So there's more to be said about practice and time. But if you're ready for that change, it can be immediate.
That's fantastic.
And I think she has a response to that. I'd love to hear it. So Kimberly, feel free to write a response to that or a follow-up question.
I don't see one yet. So, we're almost out of time. So Andrea, I've got the quiz up, and then I'll put your website back up. Is there other ways that you'd like people to connect with you?
Well, those are the best. Certainly I'm on Facebook also. So you can find me there. There's my name, Andrea Isaacs. And then I also have Andrea Isaacs EQ for emotional intelligence.
Oh, okay. Okay. And I think you'll see this is a very creative way for you to go through and live a happier life without the scary stuff. I really think this is what we're seeing, all the contrasts right now in society, in our government. It's a presidential election year coming up. And we're at the end of a decade. And if you really want to release the baggage that you've got that no longer serves you, why not start out the new decade without it?
Mm.
And go from a steamer trunk to a little carry-on.
I love that image, especially having just moved. I love the carry-on only. No, and we have a choice. That's really the most important thing for everybody to know. We do have a choice emotionally. We just have to learn how.
Right, right. And this is a unique way to learn how, that actually you could see the physical movement that it grounds it right away in. It's not an intellectual practice, and you can actually make it a game with yourself. So this could work for beings of all ages. So I encourage you to check Andrea's workout and see why people in all over the world are participating with this process and are remembering themselves, remembering who they are.
That's beautiful, Kathy. Yes. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks, everybody. Thank you.
Thanks for being here.
Yeah. Bye. Thank you.